Welcome to A Healthy Curiosity, the podcast that explores what it takes to be well in a busy world with self-care strategies from Chinese medicine. I'm your host, Brodie Welch, here to support you on your journey of health, happiness, and personal evolution. Welcome to today's show. I'm your host, Brodie Welch, a holistic self-care strategist and licensed acupuncturist. And if you've been listening to the show for a while, you have heard probably many a chat about women's hormones. We have done several episodes on things like PMS and fertility and just the yin and yang of women's hormones. Today, we're going to get into some of the things that women are less likely to talk about pertaining to menopause, aging, libido, sex, urinary incontinence, what is perimenopause. You'll get a hormone primer and what the stress connection. And with me to unpack all of this is Dr. Anna Cabeca. She's a medical doctor, a mother, an advocate for women's health, and a researcher and educator who I had the pleasure of meeting in person last month. We really hit it off. She is just a lovely human being in addition to really knowing her stuff as a Emory University trained board certified gynecologist and obstetrician, as well as board certified in anti-aging and regenerative medicine, functional medicine expert, as well as in women's health and sexual health in general. She specializes in bioidentical hormone replacement therapy and natural alternatives, successful menopause, and age management medicine. She also is the creator of Julva, a rejuvenating feminine vulvar cream for women, and is the developer of alkaline superfood drink Mighty Maca Plus, in addition to a whole bunch of other things that she's got going on. Dr. Anna Cabeca, welcome to A Healthy Curiosity.
Oh, it's wonderful to be here. And I love to have a healthy curiosity about things. So I'm excited for this interview.
Awesome. Let's start off with some basics. I think it's really worthwhile to explain the connection between stress, something that pretty much every woman listening to this show is dealing with to some degree, the connection between stress and our hormones, and why it's absolutely critical for us to get a handle on stress if we have any hope of having quote unquote hormone balance.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, one of the things that we have to understand is that our hormones, just starting from the basics, is our hormones are derived from cholesterol. And then from cholesterol, we go to pregnenolone and progesterone, and from there to either cortisol or to DHEA and our sex steroids, such as testosterone and estrogen. So when we're stressed and our like foot is pushed like pedal to the metal, so to speak, and we're like gearing up, driving 100 miles an hour from the time our feet hit the floor in the morning, whether it's physical or mental or both, right? Emotional, relational, social, perceived, and real, all of those things affect our body and put us in stress mode. So that drives us to make, you know, to put our resources, to pull all our resources together, nutrients, minerals, hormones, to make cortisol and other stress hormones that continue to drive our system. And that can be a result of PTSD, post-traumatic stress, something I know way too well, and also just chronic everyday stress. And so this leads to this hormonal imbalance in our body that just really does create havoc. We get lower levels of progesterone. So then often we notice like an estrogen dominant symptom, such as the mood swings, the PMS, the irritability, the anxiety, the weight gain, the irregular cycles, all of those things can be associated with estrogen dominance. And so stress really drives those hormones, but they have to be made from something. And so that's what I really want women to understand, is that when we're robbing Peter to pay Paul, essentially, we really have to keep filling our cup and also stop, you know, interfere with that process so that we can rebuild, restore, and replenish ourselves.
Wow, you just said a lot right there. There are so many threads to pull on. First off, you started with, well, and you made allusions to having the raw materials, right? And the fact that all of these, the stress hormones and the sex hormones, there's a relationship. There's these complex pathways that they are made along. And it starts with cholesterol.
Yeah, absolutely.
So are you talking about the cholesterol that we eat in food, or cholesterol that the body synthesizes, and what can we do to support that?
Yeah, absolutely. Like both. I mean, we have to get cholesterol. We have to use the cholesterol that we're eating or getting from our nutrients in some way and that our body's synthesizing. So really we have a combination effect filling this basket. So, you know, again, that's something we have to understand. We have to get these nutrients from somewhere. And I think too, Brodie, to put it really in perspective, it's why women in their 30s are getting osteoporosis and osteopenia, why women in their 30s are getting gray hair and sarcopenia or muscle loss, because we're lacking the essentials in many cases, but also we're pulling on our resources way too much. In our medical world, as a physician, cholesterol has been villainized for years, and it's a really important and very good structure, right? And this is one of the reasons I say, you know, women of the 80s, when we were told avoid fats and carbs are king, when actually it's the other way around in many cases, that really was destructive to our hormone because we need fats for hormonal health.
Yes, we need fats for hormonal health, and we need to be able to produce those. And we also need to be living within our energetic means, right? Like you alluded to the fact that women increasingly younger ages are showing up with what used to be like diseases like osteoporosis that we would associate with aging, right?
And right, with your grandma.
Yeah, exactly. And it's the kind of thing where in Chinese medicine, we have this analogy of that when you're living, burning the candle at both ends, dipping into your reserves, that's the kidney system. So it's like not only is it fear and fight or flight and stress, it's also your reproductive capacity. It's also your estrogen and progesterone. It's like it is all coming from the same place. And so that just like living sustainable lives is really critical to us being able to keep up with the hormone balance. You made mention of estrogen dominance and all the things that go with it, like things like weight gain, people who are struggling despite changes in their diet and exercise to lose weight, and they're blaming themselves. And a lot of times it's actually just hormone imbalance. They have too much estrogen relative to progesterone. You can also see that in things like PMS, breast tenderness. I forget even what else is on that list, but I'm curious. There are so many women in this situation, and I'd love to know what can be done about it.
Yeah. Crazy's on that list too.
Crazy, yes.
Low libido, you know, just those, you know, I always tell clients, if you hate your husband 2 weeks out of the month, it's your hormones most likely, more so than your husband. Although I'm sure he has part to blame. But it's that sense that, so with estrogen dominance, which is really interesting. So what's happening in our 30s or really now, you know, in mid 30s to late 30s, but sometimes even sooner because of hormone disruptors, estrogen mimickers. So the estrogen mimickers that we get from, you know, petrochemicals, from phthalates, plastics, from shopping receipts, all of those things can affect our bodies. Balance, right? And toxic burden that affects our estrogen metabolism and creates this estrogen dominance kind of phenomenon that adds complexity in our lives unnecessarily. So physiologically, what's happening as we're aging, the normal physiologic response is to have lower progesterone. So that's a natural reason for this estrogen dominance. Progesterone levels start to decline as our ovarian function or as our ovaries produce less and less progesterone, right? So that's one reason we get this progesterone decline or estrogen dominance. And as an OBGYN, what clients came in experiencing was essentially breakthrough bleeding, PMS, irregular or heavier periods, mood swings. And the standard of care is like, okay, well, when you have these symptoms, let's give you some Prozac or some Xanax, or, you know, let's just medicate this and maybe some birth control pills. Let's just suppress your ovaries altogether. And when we do these things, we mute the cues that signal our body and our mind and spirits and soul to take action. And it's really important to understand that the symptoms we experience are messages to us that are for us to tune into, not to wipe out,
Yeah, they're absolute invitations to do things differently. And so when we're just treating it on the level of a symptom and then seizing control over the body's function, basically letting a medication take the reins, that we miss that opportunity to listen and to bring ourselves into balance. Not to mention the fact that these xenoestrogens, these foreign estrogens from things like the growth hormone and injected into conventionally raised dairy cows that ends up in our milk, from the body products, the phthalates and parabens that you're talking about, that these things have been linked to breast cancer. And so rather than clean up our diet, to clean up our, like, what's going into our body products, like, we're not necessarily really well served by just paying attention to the symptoms.
And typically then what happens next is, you know, a patient would come back and say, well, I'm still having some breakthrough bleeding, or I'm still having some PMS symptoms. Maybe now there's some ovarian cyst forming or fibroids. And, you know, the next course of treatment may be hysterectomy, endometrial ablation, or hysterectomy. And hey, since you're over 35, why don't we just take out your ovaries while you're there? And what that does, again, that's taking out the innocent bystander of the hormonal changes in your body. So we remove the uterus, maybe remove the ovaries too. And then the patient comes back in and we, as, you know, their gynecologist are like, well, you know, maybe your next step is the divorce attorney and the psychiatrist, because I've done everything I can for you. And in fact, when I started practicing more functional medicine and using bioidentical hormones as therapy and teaching patients to get alkaline, detoxify, and creating natural solutions to help them, what I did, I went from 2 to 3 surgeries a week to 2 to 3 a year. And I witnessed firsthand the amazing healing capacity that our body has.
That's really powerful, what you just said. Because yes, like, our bodies are incredibly intelligent and they seek balance, and we just need to be doing things differently, living differently in order for our bodies to get back into balance. And that's, which isn't to say that other interventions aren't necessary, but there's so much that we can be doing to support the function of the whole ecosystem. So you use the term bioidentical hormones. Some people might not know what that is, like, that, and think about hormone replacement therapy as what 20 years ago came out with the massive study, the Framingham Women's Health study, that where everyone started to get, where it really came to light that giving women hormones that were almost like what our bodies make, but not quite, was causing an increase in things like heart attacks and strokes and certain kinds of cancer. And so bioidenticals do not carry those same risks. Is that true?
Yeah, actually, that is true. And the study was published in 2002, the first arm of the Women's Health Initiative study that looked at Premarin and Provera, so conjugated equine estrogens, in other words, estrogens from pregnant mare's urine. So that's why Premarin is the name of that product. And Provera, which is a synthetic progestin, similar to progesterone, what our body produces naturally, but not identical. And in fact, have very different profiles. Provera or progestins have increased blood clotting, increase cancer risk, increase heart disease, increase weight gain, increase water fluid gain. And that's important, something to consider, whereas bioidentical progesterone is a natural diuretic, a natural antidepressant, naturally builds up our bones, naturally is breast protective, naturally is, you know, important, essential for life, for our uterus to maintain a healthy pregnancy. So bioidentical progesterone is really important. In fact, Dr. Fournier out of France did a 100,000 person multicenter analysis of the different types of progestins and progesterones, and certainly showed that progesterone was harmless, did not have any associated increased risk of breast cancer, but progestins did, synthetic progestins did. So bioidentical progesterone, whether taken orally or transdermally, seems to be incredibly safe over the years with no increased risk. And it's something that I use very frequently and recommend very frequently for clients, especially over age 35, because we want to balance the luteal phase of the cycle, want to do it as naturally as possible through restoring every communication system, every gland in the body. And we use herbs, detoxification, meditation, all of those important lifestyle, good night's sleep, all those important lifestyle things that we have to do. But then sometimes we need added bioidentical progesterone on because we're not living in the Amazon. We're not living in the jungle. We are faced with toxins, stress, and, you know, like no other time in our history. So adding a little bioidentical progesterone can make a big difference. And I have very little to no concern about using it in small meter doses.
Do you recommend like creams or orals or sublinguals like as more powerful, or like does the form matter? You said that it really, it's effective regardless of what form you take, but is there a preferred method?
Yeah. You know, for me, I like transdermal creams because we can increase, decrease as we listen and become in tune with our body's intelligence, right? So there's a, you know, a little bit, some, you know, sometimes we need more, sometimes we need less, and type of just recognition that we can use that. Plus, like for me, I created my Pure Balance PPR cream. If I'm going to use a cream, I want to be anti-aging too. So I put in some peptides and other good ingredients, some essential oils to just make it that much better. But, you know, so creams will help relax, will help oppose the body's natural estrogen. And not all creams are created equal. Prescription oral progesterone, I've used that very often as well, because oral progesterone is metabolized more readily to something called allopregnanolone, which helps increase our levels of GABA, which is our relaxation neurotransmitter that helps us relax and rest, and natural anti-anxiety elixir, essentially, and helps get a good night's sleep. So oral progesterone can even be more powerful in those ways. And typically it's 100 milligrams or 200 milligrams orally, and only 10 to 20 milligrams transdermally or in a cream.
And if someone is not tolerating progesterone orally, are they more likely to tolerate it in a cream, or does
they
it
are? They are. Okay. Yep. And I would use it, like some of us rapidly metabolize progesterone to cortisol, especially if we're stressed out and we're driving and certain enzymes in our body and are in hyperdrive. So in that case, we might want to use it in the morning and definitely really work on stress management, cortisol reduction things. But you can start with a very small dose that way with a cream and gradually increase it. So you have more flexibility and customization with a cream.
This episode is brought to you by the coaching branch of BrodieWelch.com. If you are interested in getting off of your plateau, I have three opportunities for you. One is to join a community of like-minded people who similarly want to get more calm, more confident, be in the bodies that they love, show up differently in the world, and start really living from their truth. My Level Up community starts again in January. And if you're interested, you can head to BrodieWelch.com, Level Up page, and apply. Also, there is room in the Mexico retreat in February for a few more people. So if you could use a retreat that gets you connected to yourself, as well as giving you tons of self-care tools for your toolbox going forward, check that out as well. And three, I'm opening up time in my schedule for a handful of the right one-on-one clients for coaching, for people who are interested in getting off their plateau with kind of a combination of both health coaching and life coaching from a Chinese medicine framework. So again, all the self-care tools and empowerment, support, accountability that you could get in a group, but with some more personalized recommendations from me. And if you're interested, head to BrodieWelch.com, go to the Level Up page and apply to have a conversation with me, and we'll see if it's a good fit. Now back to the show. Awesome. Yeah, I flirted with progesterone for a little while, and I think that I had a paradoxical reaction to it, that, or at least that's what my OBGYN told me, was that I must be one of that very small percentage of women who has a
very small percent.
Because I utterly couldn't sleep at all.
Did you try using it in the morning?
I don't remember. I think so. But it's been a while. It's been a few years. You mentioned, I want to circle back to something that you just mentioned a minute ago, which is detoxification. So we've mentioned the fact that we're not living in the Amazon. We're in this world that is full of stressors and also full of toxins and full of these estrogen mimicking and foreign estrogens that take up our body's estrogen receptors. Maybe we've been on birth control pills. Maybe we've been on exposed to things that definitely have added to the level of estrogenic load to our bodies. And if a woman is interested in detoxifying from estrogen and getting rid of some of that, that can be difficult, right? Because it's fat soluble and it hangs out in the body. It's not just that. So what do we do? How can we get a handle on shedding some of that which could be harmful bad guys lurking in our system?
Yeah, honestly, you can really do it very quickly. We really can, because again, the body, just think the intestinal tract's regenerating on a 72-hour basis. So one of the things that I talk about in my book coming up, which is the hormone fix, is extending intermittent fasting. So with giving the gut a chance to rest and getting keto green or keto alkaline, as I like to say, you know, getting enough minerals through our nutrients, we're handling stress, because it's not just food that affects our body's urine, you know, pH. So we want to improve that process, improves detoxification, improves the metabolism of estrogen as it's improving our gut microbacteria and the diversity of our gut microbacteria. So I think that's really important to understand that we can do it quickly. And it's so important to do. If our listeners today haven't been on a good detoxification program, you know, sometimes we'll add liver support, definitely Chinese medicine herbs that can definitely help with liver detoxification. That's really important because the enzymes that are needed to detoxify estrogen are all in the liver. So that can really determine if we have highly toxic and bad estrogens or safe and helpful estrogens. And we really want to tip the cart into our favor. And we do that through stress management and improving our gut bacteria and our diet. So in those ways, we can really improve our overall health, well-being, hormone balance, sanity, all those good things.
Yes. Great. Well, that's empowering. Knowing that it does not necessarily take long, and it's something that we can do simply by shifting the timing of when we're eating, by eating more on the alkaline side. That's so essentially eating lots of plants is what you're saying, and eating more fat, and kind of that keto approach.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely.
So basically, and I'm not certainly an expert in the keto diet, but essentially it sounds like what you're saying is just de-emphasizing the carbs, relying more on fat, so that we have the hormonal precursors that we need to make hormones.
Yeah. Healthy fats, healthy proteins, you know, green carbs, really filling up on that.
Yeah.
And testing, not guessing. So in my programs, I have women check their urine, pH and ketones, and periodically bump into ketosis, but really work on staying alkaline. And that makes a difference. When we're getting older, I'm 52 with a 10-year-old, so I got to keep my mental faculties around me. But brain fog's a real issue. And one of the reasons is, Brodie, is because as estrogen declines, I mean, estrogen's necessary for glycolysis in the brain. It's necessary for glucose utilization in the brain. So it's not just that we're getting older that we're getting brain fog. It's that we're relying on the wrong source of fuel. So relying on ketones, and that's not from a carnivore keto diet, right? It's not from all meats. And, you know, it's really from intermittent fasting. We need less. Our body needs time to digest and rest. I mean, our ancestors had long periods of fasting. Religious organizations from around the world, Greek Orthodox, fast, there's 200 days a year of prolonged or intermittent fast. So that's huge. And we have, you know, maybe that was built in for for spiritual health, but there was probably some practical recognition that it's overall improves the health, well-being, and mental status of our population, especially our elders, for sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I have this discussion with people a lot, right? That the importance of getting into fat burning mode, because if we're just eating every few hours, we're running on glucose when we're training ourselves to need to be fed every 2 hours, and we're never going to burn our fat or the toxins that our fat is storing. And then, as you were saying, like the brain prefers fat as fuel, and we'll have a lot more mental clarity. And you also are just having us see that estrogen is not just to be feared, that there's like, we need it. We need it to help us think. It makes the tissue supple, and it helps us feel, well, as you put it earlier, sane. And yet women, for example, like I treat lots of women who are in recovery from breast cancer, or like who have just had surgery for breast cancer, and they're put on these aromatase inhibitors or like estrogen blocking medications. And they're really confused about how to support themselves. They wonder whether it's a good idea to be avoiding foods that have estrogens in them, plant-based estrogens, things like flax or fermented soy. What's your take on this? Do phytoestrogens have a protective effect for women? Is it potentially dangerous?
Like, I would totally say that's looking at sand in the bucket, not looking at the big rocks, right?
Yeah.
So you can focus on the sand, but if you're not looking at the big rocks and the big shells, I mean, you're going to get cut. So the big issues are what we know. Let's say this way, we know that intermittent fasting, keeping even just 12.5 hours between dinner and breakfast, significantly decreases breast cancer recurrence. Huge, huge piece of information every woman needs to know. So hence, get keto green. That's number one. That's the big picture. You're so much powerful. Keep up with healthy amounts of phytonutrients, right? It's the other stuff that's really creating the toxins. Look, as we clean up, I mean, variety is the spice of life, and I will totally adhere to that. So no soy every day, you know, and if you're having soy, let it be non-GMO fermented soy, such as miso or tempeh, and that can actually promote healthy estrogen detoxification according to what the research says. So that's really important to understand. Avoid the, you know, petrochemicals, the pesticides, herbicides, all those organochemicals that can disrupt your body as well. And, you know, handle stress, enjoy the relationships you love, laugh a lot, have sex a lot. All of those are really big factors that can move the needle for you with any woman with breast cancer. And the other thing is, you know, we talk a lot about the effects of what I just actually was in a conversation yesterday with a woman who had been diagnosed with breast cancer twice. And we were talking about the fallout, right? Women who have had cancer or really so many disease, or once we hit a certain age, seriously, we're written off. And that makes me angry, because it's like, oh, here, just give her another pill and, you know, tell her to come back in 6 months, or here, you know, or worse, women are writing themselves off because they feel like this is as good as it gets. And that's so not true. And that really makes me angry, Brodie. So I love what you're doing. And I love that we're having this conversation, because I want to tell women that, you know, the spirit within us, we know this intuitively, has not aged. It is just wiser, and it can be, we allow it to be bolder, more beautiful, more potent than ever, because God designed our bodies in a way to nurture and optimize our spirit. It's just when we are in sickness and dis-ease and illness that we have that conflict within us, and we can heal ourselves. Like I said, the intestinal lining is regenerating on a 72-hour basis. Our body renews and renews and renews. We give it the right essential nutrients, the right environment, the right frame of mind, and love and self-love, then we can renew and restore ourselves. And I've seen it over and over again. Women who've had metastatic cancer to just feeling depressed, anxious, and burnout. All of us can improve our health and condition, and very quickly.
Amen, sister. I love your passion there. That's awesome.
I don't want anyone to write themselves off. It just does upset me. I mean, I was in my clinic one day, and I was seeing a woman and she was coming in for hormonal issues and saw a picture of me doing a triathlon on the wall. And she's like, "Oh my God, that's awesome." I said, "Yeah, I just finished that a couple weeks ago." And it was a sprint triathlon. And I said, "Yeah, it was my first one." She goes, "Oh, well, I'm too old to do that." And I looked at her chart. She was 38 years old. I was 42 when I completed that triathlon, or 43. And I was like, "Hey, I'm 43. And she's like, "Oh, well, you know," I'm like, "Why are you writing yourself off?" You know, I'm like,
it's that thing, like the growth mindset versus fixed mindset issue, right? That if you believe that what is now is what you're destined for and what will always be, or if you look around you and you say, "Well, all my friends are 70 and falling apart, therefore, like, it must just be getting old." And it's the kind of thing where people do not see how there are so many different ways to show up as 70 or a 50 or 30. It's like that how we live has so much more to do with what we experience at these different phases in life.
Well said. Yes.
And speaking of writing themselves off, a lot of women who are experiencing that decline in libido, like in their 30s, the perimenopausal sort of slump, and so much of it, I believe, is just because they're so exhausted. They're doing way too much. They're stressed out. And that's not exactly signaling to the body that it's like sexy, sexy time. So it's the kind of thing where like there's not a lot of leftover energy for libido, for having sex. And also it's like, there is that shift, right? And there's plenty of women who are in menopause, but who don't want to write off their sex life. And yet it can be more painful, right? There can be more vaginal pain with sex as that which is yin, which is moistening, nourishing, providing suppleness and flexibility, is not as abundant. And so how can we support things like libido and orgasm and our overall sexual pleasure?
Yeah, I actually have a free webinar called "Help Doctor, My Sex Drive Has No Pulse," which is really great because I talk about some key areas that men and women just understanding about each other that makes a difference. And then the whole program is called Sexual CPR, you know, I mean, putting life back into sex and sex back into our lives because it is important. It nurtures oxytocin, which is the hormone of love and bonding and connection, and it's really the most powerful hormone in our body. And so I love that, you know, we're open to talking about this because one of the things women don't realize is as we're under stress or we're, you know, on birth control or we're on antihistamines or we're just, you know, burning the candle at both ends, that vaginal dryness is a real phenomenon that causes discomfort and pain and irritation and discharge and urinary infection, all these things that happen that lead us not to want, and it's subconscious, not to want to have more sex. And I tell women, man, if you have pain every time you do something, why would you want to do that thing? And that's like a big aha moment. So even though it's something, because we're not going to say it because we love our partner, we want to, but we're feeling our bodies naturally saying, "Oh, well, let's not go there because it's going to be uncomfortable. It's not going to be great. Or, you know, it's not as fun as it used to be," or whatever the situation was, versus, okay, well, how do I restore this? How do I bring nourishment back into my natural body? And that's one of the reasons, like, that was a really big aspect of, and working with women with sexual health, working as a bioidentical hormone specialist, I wanted to create a natural solution for women. And so that led me to create Jolva, which is a anti-aging vulvar cream. So use it from the clitoris to the anus. I mean, we worry about wrinkle lines around our eyes, mouth, lips, right? But it's really important to consider what's happening in our pelvic floor because it leads to things. I mean, vaginal dryness continues, incontinence worsens. All of those things happen as we age unless we really empower our pelvic floor and give it the nourishment that we need. We put on lip gloss, we put on eye creams, but we weren't paying any attention to our pelvic floor. And the standard model of using estrogen just isn't satisfactory. So that's a big part of what can lead us to lose our libido. And also another part of the loss of libido is just the understanding, the realization, the physiology drives behavior. So again, there's that stress factor. Cortisol's up, makes oxytocin go down. So we have that less innate ability or desire to connect. So we also need to realize that our sexual desire and drive as women is different from men, and it's a secondary desire. So what my patients would tell me, they would say, Dr. Anna, no, I have no libido, but once we get started, I'm okay. After I heard that a couple times, I'm like, huh, you know, I knew that Masters-Johnson curve was wrong. And then I looked, and there's actually another model called a secondary sexual desire model that women have. And it's based on a scientist's work called Dr. Basson. And it's actually 100% correct. So once we get started, our hormones of connection, love, desire, all of those start to get warmed up. And then we're like, oh, I'm okay. Maybe I'm in for this. You know, I think we've experienced that. And that is natural. That is normal. So the key is to be receptive. But when estrogen declines, stress is high, our androgens are low, it's hard to be receptive. So then it becomes, we have to implement a practice and a purpose to make this time for nourishment and intimacy. Now, does that sound sexy? No, but let me tell you, once you get started, you'll be there. Once you get started, you'll get there.
Oh, I hear that from women all the time. Is that like, okay, I might not have the same like desire to rip my partner's clothes off, but at the same time, once we get going, you know, like dot, 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 there's that, yeah, things happen, things evolve. And part of that, I think, is it takes a conscious conversation, especially if your partner is a guy, right? That not all of like the intimacy, nakedness, kissing, touching, rolling around necessarily has to lead to penetration, intercourse, right? Like that there can be pleasure, there can be exploring each other's bodies and feeling close, and that women can, it really takes the pressure off to expand your definition of what sex is and to allow for what your body's wanting in the moment instead of feeling like, okay, well, I have to get warmed up enough to accommodate penetration, which may or may not be comfortable or like what your body's wanting at that particular minute in time. So it's a lot of times I feel like the kind of thing that when you can talk to your partner about what you want, which can include the whole spectrum, right? The oxytocin, yummy, connective stuff, as well as the hot and heavy that you're probably everybody's needs will get met.
Yeah. And that's lovely. That's nourishing. That just is part of keeping in tune and intimate on many levels.
And just the fact that it can actually be so healthful to experience orgasm, right? And you can talk about like, yeah, like we pay all this attention to the stuff on our face and like really getting the chi and blood to flow into our root chakra, to our sexual organs, to our pelvic floor, that all of that, like that orgasm is a tremendous mover of energy, you know, and it's like, it's a way of unblocking and helping us to connect with some powerful creative energy and to indeed a sense of power on a lot of levels. So it's a good thing to keep going. As long as
favorite. Absolutely.
And getting back to Jelva, which I think is a brilliant innovation. I mean, it's amazing to me that here we are in the 21st century and that there is so little available and dedicated towards women being able to really care for their lady parts. And you've come up with this ingredient list that's like super clean and natural and also help with that urinary stuff, right? Like that can be super embarrassing for women or like make them feel really old to have this leakage and incontinence. And how can it help with that?
Yeah. I mean, I just always tell women, you know, it's bad enough that we get lip lines or wrinkles around the eyes or mouth or whatever we're noticing. And, but when we start, you know, we can't do our activities because we're worried about accidental leaks, like when we're jogging or jumping on a rebounder or laughing or sneezing and we're getting these experiences, we have to understand it's just like we lose the muscle strength under our arm, our triceps muscles. We worry about the arm wag and we have to exercise those muscles. So with exercise and with androgen therapy, the two combination can really help. So in putting in a little bit of DHEA, which is a precursor to some testosterone and estrogen, and just in and of itself is a very great anti-aging peptide hormone, it really does make a difference in our body. So that with plant stem cells that I use from the Alpine Rose, which is a rose, and I had to have this ingredient when I learned about this. It's a rose that grows in the Swiss Alps amidst the harsh conditions of the ice and snow and rocks and just blossoms beautifully. I'm like, oh yeah, that's the definition of women right there. And it just has incredible anti-aging benefits, antiviral benefits, and it's been shown in research to do that. So I use that in combination with other ingredients, including emu oil, coconut oil, shea butter, and formulated it in Jelva, which is patent pending, just really great product that has helped women in so many ways. And just like, again, just as we want to keep the condition of our body healthy as much as possible, can't forget the pelvic floor, full of muscles, full of nerve endings, full of blood supply, very vascular. The vaginal health itself is very, very vascular. And so it can really work to help restore, you know, restore itself very quickly. And so after years of research and working with so many clients and patients, you know, I created Jelva to be able to be used, and it's been great. A little side tip is that, you know, I watched my Christian Dior red lipstick have a little bit of bleeds on my lips when I had my lip wrinkles. And I'm like, man, I got to use Jelva on my lips here too. And lo and behold, no more lip wrinkles, no more lipstick bleeds. Lips down there, awesome. But you can watch it work up here. So if that doesn't make you smile, I don't know.
That's awesome. That's awesome. So I really appreciate all of your knowledge and everything that you've shared with us today. And I am also cognizant that we are running short on time. So if people want to connect with you and perhaps get involved with any of your programs or any of the products that you offer, where should they be going? And of course, we'll have links to all of this in the show notes.
Yes, absolutely. So my website, very easily come to see me at dranna.com. So dranna.com. And that will bring you to me. And I look forward to seeing you there. And please sign up for my newsletter, follow me on social, and, you know, drop me a line. Tell me that you heard me and Brodie here having a beautiful conversation. I look forward to that.
Well, thank you again so much for sharing your knowledge and expertise with all of us here on A Healthy Curiosity. Thanks for listening today. For more episodes of A Healthy Curiosity, you can visit the iTunes store. If you appreciated today's show, please leave us a review. This helps other people to find the podcast. You could also head to brodiewelch.com, where you can find free self-care resources, learn more about Chinese medicine, and let me know what you'd like to hear about on future episodes. I'd love to hear from you. Till next time, be good to yourself.